Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Nama saya Dr. Syirina Syirin binti Rizlan Ross. Saya adalah pakar perunding kanak-kanak di Hospital Avicenna Women's and Children Hospital di Shah Alam. Hari ini kita akan berbincang tentang topik gastroenterology ataupun sistem pencernaan dan penghadaman di kalangan kanak-kanak. Sebelum kita teruskan dengan soalan-soalan, saya akan terangkan apa itu gastroenterology. Gastroenterology is the part of medicine that concentrates on the digestion of food that we eat. The process starts from the mouth, where we chew and break down the food boluses. It will then go through the esophagus, through the process of peristalsis, into the stomach, where the food bolus will be digested for about 2 to 4 hours through acid secretion of the stomach. Once pre-digestion has occurred in the stomach, the food bolus then will be passed through to the small intestine, where all the absorption of nutrients takes place. The remnant of the digestion and water absorption will occur in the large intestine or colon, which will then eventually produce stools to be excreted through the anus. I have 3 questions today. The first one is, dear doctor, I have a 3-year-old son who is constipated, teruk, menangis setiap hari, help doc. Okay, so first and foremost, it is very important for us to know that constipation in children is very common. Yeah, it is also important to know the onset of the problem. So in this 3-year-old child, he is at the crucial age for toilet training. This is very, very important with regards to the constipation, because at this point, between the ages of 2 to 4, children will be able to feel their anal sphincter, which is a muscle that controls the function of the anus. So if the child experiences a painful episode during defecation, semasa nak buang air besar kalau sakit, then dia akan takut. He'll be too scared to go to the toilet for regular poos. Yeah? When this happens, dia akan cuba menahan. He will try and retain the stools from coming out. So this then causes more prolonged water absorption in the large bowel, in the colon, yang menyebabkan the stools will become harder and harder to pass. So this more dehydrated stools will make it even harder for the child to toilet. And when this happens, the stools yang keluar tu akan menyebabkan dia lagi sakit dan dia akan lagi takut nak ke toilet. Yeah? So this is a vicious cycle that we have to break. The first and foremost, the ways to counter this problem is, so the first step in breaking this vicious cycle is we need to soften the stools. Yeah? There are many ways that we can do this. Lalunya bila dah sampai had macam ni, anak semua nangis-nangis nak ke toilet, we have to use medication. Once the child believes that pooing does not cause pain, then only he will poo on a regular basis. Then dia tak akan menahan najis tu from keluar. So that's the first step, okay? The second step then is to maintain good bowel movement by maintaining good health, good diet, good fluid intake, and lots of exercises. Because we know that physical exercises can help the motility and the squeezing of our large bowel to ensure passage of the stools on a regular basis. Step three. We need to get the child to regularly go to the toilet. So it is very important, especially after main meals. So after breakfast, after lunch, after dinner, and once before bedtime. Step four, we need to be positive. We need to encourage them positively. It is very easy to lose your patience and your temper bila anak kita tak nak pergi toilet, susah pergi toilet, and sometimes have accidents as well in between. Last but not least, step five is to maintain your patience and don't give up. We as parents have to know that this is not something that the child chooses to do. Yeah, we have to help them patiently. And also, most importantly, what I always tell my parents is that this is a marathon and not a sprint. So the problem is not going to go away overnight. We have to have the strength and the patience to see it through. Now we go to the second question. So the question is, anak saya muntah kalau minum air bersusu. Normal ke, doktor? Okay, this is a very non-specific question to the age of the child because gastroenterology dalam pediatrics ni dia luas dan masalah dia pun berbeza-beza mengikut umur anak kita, ya. So kalau katalah yang tak boleh minum ni, yang selalu muntah ni, anak dia berumur 1 dan ke bawah, ya, baby. So in that case obviously it's not normal sebab susu ialah makanan ruji kepada anak-anak kecil kita, ya, our babies. It could be that dia ada dua masalah, either yang nombor satu, cow's milk protein allergy ataupun alahan kepada susu protein susu, ataupun yang kedua, lactose intolerance, which is intolerance to the sugar in milk. When we talk about problems with milk and milk digestion, only two things matter in the content of the milk. It's the protein and the sugar, which is lactose. Okay, if the child is older, for example, and katalah 8 years old child, for example, yang muntah bila minum susu, and sebelum ni dia tak ada masalah penghadaman dengan pencernaan susu, so it's unlikely that this is due to anything serious. So I think at this point we have to examine the child, make sure tak ada masalah lain, dia tak ada masalah penghadaman nutrient-nutrient yang lain. Yeah, so it's very difficult for me to come to a conclusion lah based on the very limited information that I receive. Yeah, the other thing about muntah ni, whatever age it is of the child, it is important kita tahu timing muntah tu in relation to pemakanan atau minuman. Is it immediate? Is it sejam atau dua jam lepas makan? Ataupun many hours after? Because that will tell us whether our process of pencernaan tu is going in the right fashion and in the right timing. So the third question, which is the last question, says, when should I be concerned about my kid's stomach ache? Now, this is a question that I get very often, yeah, because stomach ache ataupun sakit perut ataupun recurrent abdominal pain is very, very common in children. Yeah, 1 in 3 children will have it. Yeah, it up to 15% of Malaysian school children will suffer from sakit perut ataupun recurrent abdominal pain. Yang penting, whether to know to be worried atau tidak, is kita kena cuba membezakan antara functional abdominal pain dan pathological abdominal pain. This can be done through a good history and examination of the child. In 80% of cases, the diagnosis can be found after a very good history and examination. And normally, investigations are undertaken in the 10 to 15% just to confirm the suspicion when the diagnosis has already been suspected by the doctor. So, when do we need to worry? Number one, the severity of the abdominal pain. If the child selama ni sihat walafiat, tak ada masalah, and then suddenly one day he wakes up, menangis-nangis, berguling-guling on the floor, then obviously that is not normal. Obviously he needs to be examined, yeah, to make sure that there is nothing acute in the way of infection, inflammation dan sebagainya. Number two, location of the sakit perut tu. Bila kita kata perut, bukannya kat perut je. Perut kita merangkumi the whole of the abdomen. Yeah? There are many organs in the abdomen yang boleh produce the symptom of pain. Okay? So, location tu kat mana? Is it dekat tengah where your umbilical area is? Dekat pusat. So, kalau anak-anak kita kata sakit perut dia mainly dekat pusat dan tak ada bergerak ke mana-mana, in most cases, this is functional abdominal pain. Kalau dia point to anywhere away from the pusat, say for example, dekat bawah on the left ataupun dekat bawah on the right, then those are areas yang selalu anak-anak kita tak akan point. So, those places kita kena pay a little bit more attention sebab it could be kalau on the right tu, the child has appendicitis, which is not functional abdominal pain. Adakah dia simptom lain? Systemic symptom macam muntah, low appetite, yeah, diarrhea dan sebagainya. Ada demam tinggi atau tidak? Because these are all signs of possible infection of the gastrointestinal tract. Is there association dengan sakit kepala? Because migraine in children can present with abdominal pain, which is what we call abdominal migraine. Is there family history of migraine? Yeah, mak, abah, cousins, adik-beradik ada tak yang ada migraine? Satu lagi, ada tak simptom-simptom seperti pedih bila membuang air kecil, ya? Sakit perut dia yang bergerak ke belakang, because these are signs of possible pyelonephritis ataupun upper kidney infection ataupun lower urinary tract infection. The age of the child is also important, because the younger the child presenting with acute abdominal pain, the more chances that this is abnormal, yeah, the more chances that this is pathological, dan memerlukan a good history, a comprehensive examination and some investigations to come to a conclusion or a diagnosis. So in summary, the gastrointestinal tract is a long organ in our body that can present with many symptoms depending on which part of the tract that is affected. If your child has any of these symptoms that we discussed today, please don't hesitate to seek medical attention.